some 17 years. They were on a wide-ranging topics: Christianity in the Muslim world, modern liturgy, justification and sanctification and atonement, Hebrew translations, all the hardcore stuff. There were summations of what I believed back when I knew everything. These papers were fun to read again, with my attempts to be creative and to think out of the box. I guess I'm supposed to tell you that when I reread what I wrote all those years ago, that my soul could barely stomach all that gibberish. I should say that I've grown up, that I don't believe those things anymore, that I've experienced and learned so much more since then, that I'm a changed person. I could even quote 1 Corinthians. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. But I'm not going there. I won't go there. Because the more I read my old theology, the more I realized that it hasn't changed one bit. Not in the things that matter. My core values have not changed over the decades. What has changed, though, is life. Hello in there, Lob. It's 2015. Wake up, you old hippie. In less than 6 months, it's going to be Christmas again. Seriously, things are different. I'm in my early 60s. We have one grandchild and another on the way in December. I have only one eye. I'm retired from my job in New York and already looking forward to applying for Social Security benefits. The bottom line is, nothing stays the same. You come to realize that life is all about moving targets. Life is like a giant chessboard in which everything moves one space at a time, together, constantly. You may not notice anything in the short term, but when you look across a span of time, you know that everything is reordered and jumbled up. Jesus gives us a sense of this whirlwind nature of our lives from our scripture this morning, from the book of Mark. He's a busy guy. And by reading between the lines, we get an idea of what Jesus thinks is the wise way with this giant chessboard that we are on. It's still early in his ministry. Just recently, he has called his 12 disciples. He's been hiking along the Sea of Galilee. Then he goes to the village of Capernaum and casts out demons. He stops over at Peter's house, whose mother-in-law is sick. He heals her as well. The next morning he goes off to a quiet place to pray, where no one can find him. But sure enough, he shortly moves on to other towns and other cities, a traveling mission, constantly seeking lost souls. He keeps moving. The targets of his faith keep moving, so he moves. And I think that's the key in all this. Don't stay stationary. It's not the nature of life to stop, so we better not stop as well. Did you notice that the healing of Jesus and the way that his faith shifted from where he was to where he needed to go? He freed himself from what the people wanted and instead directed himself toward what the people needed. The whole city had gathered to seek his touch. His fame was growing. Scripture says he was exhausted. He needed renewal. something we can remember when we feel as if the whole world is looking for us or looking for something from us. That's the time to get away, to be alone, to disconnect, to take Sabbath, to redefine our purposes and priorities. Then move on. Keep our own target moving. Life moves, and so must we. Comedian Stephen Wright, with his funny one-liner, says, "I got a new shadow. I had to get rid of the old one. It wasn't doing what I wanted it to do." Jesus could have set up a healing shop and stayed along the shores of the Galilee his whole life. He could have set up a walk-in clinic and let the demons and the sick people come to him. But no, he kept moving on. He changed the target of his faith to include each of us who need his healing today. In our time of need, he comes to us. Jesus comes to where we are and heals and comforts and forgives. We in the 21st century have so many new things thrown at us all the time. Forget about comparing 2015 to the ancient world. How about things that weren't even on the horizon a few years ago? Like the uprising of ISIS and other terror groups. Are we for or against the Confederate flag coming down in South Carolina? What's your take on homosexual marriage? How about marijuana that is suddenly legal? Will Donald Trump make a good president? All those subjects and more redefine how we view the world and our part in it. The lens through which I view the world has largely stayed the same. How about you? That would be my understanding of Scripture, my gratefulness for salvation, my delight in God's grace, and my assurance of the joys to come. All these things still define my life. It's just that everything else is different. I don't recognize my hometown of Flemington anymore. New developments that are sprouting up everywhere have got me a little scared and nervous. My car needs replacing. I can't stay up like I used to. I can't labor out in the yard very long anymore. Reading longer than a half an hour gets my eyes tired. Life is all about moving targets. Yet, God's love doesn't move. That's our assurance. Psalm 36 says, "How precious is your unchanging love, O God." Healing happens right where we are, right when and where we need it to. And not just to our bodies, but to our hearts, minds, and souls, perpetually. Even if my body won't last, I'm assured that my soul will be healed perfectly and eternally. God heals the anger that poisons us. God heals the sorrows that will cripple us. God heals the doubts, the failures, and the pain. Often as not, it's done as undramatically as the scene that Mark paints for us in our scripture when he heals Peter's mother-in-law. It's stated so simply, Jesus took her by the hand. That's all it says that Jesus did to heal her. Jesus took her by the hand. None of us would even know that Peter had a mother-in-law or was married, except for the fact that on the day that Jesus happened to be at Peter's house, his mother-in-law had a fever. And this scripture always opens up a can of worms. Who was Peter's wife? What was it like being married to a disciple? Did she have a role to play in his ministry? Did they have children? Being 21st century preachers, we want our gospel writers to give us more personal data about these wonderful people who became the bearers of the Word of God. We want details. We want information, even if there's nothing scandalous to be found. How much could we learn about their characters if we knew more about their lives and about their dreams and about their loves? But then we need to come back to earth. We realize Mark and the other gospel writers could have told us those things, but they didn't. It's because their agenda was different. They told us what was important for us to know in the spiritual realm and omitted the rest. Maybe that's a lesson there that's meant for us to learn. Maybe we don't need to know who Peter was married to. And if that's true, maybe we shouldn't care so very much about the private lives of our politicians, our celebrities, our athletes, or about the life of Bruce Jenner and how many dresses he owns. Or should I call her Caitlyn Jenner? What I'm suggesting is that the most important thing that the gospel writers were interested in telling us was how Jesus related to people. The relationship between them and God. Yes, life keeps changing. The targets keep moving around, but our relationship to God doesn't. That's solid as a rock. The prophet Isaiah in the Old Testament tells of a promise by God. The promise is God will always strengthen us no matter where we are or what our situation. That promise came true to Peter's mother-in-law that day, as it has come true in each of our lives also. Healing always moves the targets of our faith. Jesus freed Peter's mother-in-law from her illness, just as right before that, he freed a man that had unclean spirits. And it's good to be freed from something, wouldn't you say? Peter's mother-in-law was healed, and Scripture says she immediately began to serve them. And that's not a matter of sexism, that an old woman begins to serve her young healer. That misses the point. The point is that the mother-in-law's gift was her hospitality, that she used what she knew best, how to respond to God. And when you and I realize that we're healed, the best thing we can do is to take our very best talent and present it to God. In the book of Genesis, Abel cooked sweet meat and offered it up to God, which was pleasing to God's senses. His brother Cain, however, only managed to round up some sun-wilted vegetables. And God said Cain's offering wasn't good enough. That kind of thinking can mess up churches as well. We try to get others or ourselves to do what is unnatural for us, and it turns out poorly. You've got the ability to sing, but instead you sign up to paint the fellowship hall. You're handy with a hammer, but you sign up for the finance team. You're a wizard with a budget, and yet you want to teach VBS. That's not how the game of serving works. When it comes to God, we need to step forward with our best. God wants our best and nothing else. So when you've been healed in this fast-moving world, use your gifts to bring healing to others. When your life changes, your faith doesn't have to change. Jesus took the woman by the hand and healed her. Whose hand can you take? Who needs you? Take their hand. Who has anger? Jesus talking or saying anything. There's no quotation marks used at all. It's because the words didn't matter. What matters was that Jesus took the woman's hand and healed her. Life is a series of moving targets. If we really want to follow Jesus, we have to keep moving ourselves onto new horizons and to new ideas. We may not be able to go as fast or high or as carefree as we used to, but our faith always stays the same. We heal.